Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, everyone. Welcome to another webinar by Data Platform Geeks. My name is Rohit, and I will be your host for today. And today's webinar is on SQL Server concurrency by our speaker, Satya Ramesh. Edominus Systems, as you must already know, that Data Platform Geeks is one of the brands under Edominus Systems. We all also have the Data Platform Summit, which is an annual conference that happens every year in the month of August. We recently concluded DPS 2018 as well. We have SQL Maestros. We have SQL Maestros, where we offer advanced SQL training and hands-on labs, which are self-paced online labs. We have PeopleWare India, where we offer a lot of trainings on almost all the technologies. And we have an ERP product called the Expand SM ERP. As I mentioned earlier, Data Platform Summit 2018, it was held from 9th to 11th August. It was a three-day conference. And we had pre-cons, 12 full-day classroom in-depth trainings on 7th and 8th. It happened at Radisson Blu, which is a five-star property in Bellindur, Bengaluru. As you all can see here, it was a huge success. We had participation of over 900 people from more than 300 companies coming from 16 countries. We have already started working towards DPS 2019. We will have 3 days of conference again, and also 3 days of pre-cons this time. One of the reasons our summit is majorly loved by everyone is because it's 100% learning and 0% marketing. So please do explore our previous summits. Visit www.dps10.com. And if you have any queries, you can always send us an email to contact@dps10.com. This is the DPG core team, the founder and president, Mr. Amit Bansal, Vice President Manohar Puna, and the regional mentors, Avanish, Sandeep, Prince, and Surbi. We also have had a recent new member for regional mentor, Vijay Mishra. These are the teams, Edominer and Kolkata teams. This is the DPG core team and the Edominer teams on the stage at the conference this year. Special thanks to Microsoft for supporting us for our community initiatives. You all are already members of the DPG community, so you can all access all our free content, all our labs, free videos, learning resources. You all can join our Facebook, LinkedIn, and Telegram groups as well. Post your questions, and you can answer others' questions as well. All our webinars are recorded, and we post them on YouTube, so you can visit our channel. It will be put up shortly in our chat window, and you can join the community on Telegram as well. Without any further delay, let's get started with the webinar. Please welcome Satya Ramesh, and please post your questions in the Q&A panel. Satya will answer them at the end of the session. Over to you, Satya.
Thank you, Rohit. Thank you for your introduction. And I'll just share my screen. Please confirm you're able to see my screen or not. Can you see my screen? Hello? Oh, okay. Please put up S in chat window if you can hear me as well. Everyone, please put up S in chat window. Yes, everyone can hear me. So we are good to go. So good afternoon, good evening, and good morning to everyone, depending upon where you have joined from. So today, our discussion is all about concurrency problems inside SQL Server. So if you have any questions while we are going on, you are feel free to put up your questions in Q&A panel so that at the end of the session, we'll take the questions. So let's go ahead and start our session today. So what is our agenda? So today, before going into concurrency problems, I'll just introduce what is a transaction and what are the transaction properties and few basics around how logs happens and what is logs and how SQL Server uses logs to maintain concurrency, to maintain consistency as well. And different isolation levels and concurrency problems inside SQL Server when you run your SQL Server under a pessimistic concurrency level. So these are the things we'll go and discuss in today's class. So let's discuss what is a transaction. So if you look at the definition, every query batch that runs inside SQL Server is a transaction. So whatever query you have run inside SQL Server, be it a simple select query, select star from employee table. So it's a transaction for SQL Server. So whatever queries you are running inside SQL Server is a transaction for SQL Server. If you do not mention explicitly by using begin tran keywords, then it is called as implicit transaction. And if you mention begin tran and then start your update or select queries, and then at the end of the transaction, you can either commit or roll back. These are called explicit transactions inside SQL Server. So all implicit transaction, whenever you write ADAW queries like select star from table name, these are all auto committed transactions. So you don't need to explicitly commit those transactions because you haven't started that explicitly. So implicit transactions are auto committed. If anything goes wrong in between, while SQL Server is performing the operation, SQL Server will automatically roll back as well. So, and second one is explicit transaction, which uses vstart using begin tran keywords, and usually end by committing it, or if something goes wrong, we're rolling back it. So these are the few basics around what is a transaction. So every transaction, I'll put it this way, every DBMS system, in order to qualify as RDBMS system, relational database management system, so that particular product has to follow four properties. So every DBMS system, DBMS product, be it Oracle, DB2, SQL Server, or MySQL, any DBMS product, in order to prove itself as a relational database management system, so it has to qualify four properties. They are atomicity, consistency, isolation, and durability. So these are the four properties every RDBMS product should follow. So what is an atomicity? So a transaction must be in atomic unit of work in nature, meaning, so if a transaction starts, either it has to do everything that is there inside the transaction, or it should not do anything. So it cannot leave the transaction in between. So you start doing it, complete doing it, or else don't do anything. So every transaction must be atomic in nature. So that is what atomicity means. So second one is consistency. So a transaction should not leave a database in its related structures in inconsistent state. So you have started a transaction and something happens, you should roll back to the previous state. You should not leave the data as it is. That will lead to inconsistent data. So this is the property you should maintain. So third one is isolation. So a transaction should see the data only before or after the concurrent transaction gets complete. So what happens is, what do you mean by concurrent transaction? Because there are two transactions started at the same time accessing the same data. So this is called concurrent access. So multiple users are accessing the same database. This is called concurrent access. So if multiple users are accessing the same thing, one transaction, say transaction A, should see the data of transaction B before that starts, or else either it completes. It should not see in between. If you see in between, there are problems that we are going to discuss in today's session. So this is called isolation. And last and final one is durability. All the transactions should be persisted despite system failure. So whatever you perform in SQL Server, you should record everything. That is why transaction logs are there. LDF files exist in SQL Server to record everything, and it will write into disk in frequent manner. So even though sometimes system failure happens, you can still read the data. So this is called durability. So from all of these four properties, atomicity, consistency, and durability, we don't need to bother because SQL Server is taking care of it. So all these three properties, we don't need to bother about because SQL Server is taking care of it. So there is something else we need to take care that is, in different cases in HAD or high availability, we need to take care using replication and other techniques. But according to these four properties, atomicity, consistency, and durability, SQL Server will take care of for us. So what we need to take care? So this is isolation. So isolation is one thing that we as a users who are using databases, who are developing databases, should take care of. So whenever you are opening up a connection to SQL Server from your application. So that application will open up in one of the five default levels, five isolation levels that are available in SQL Server. So what are those five isolation levels? First one is read and committed. Second one, read committed, repeatable read, serializable, and snapshot. These are the five different isolation levels that are available in SQL Server. There is one more isolation level called read committed snapshot isolation, or CSI, that actually it's optimistic level of read committed that we are not going to discuss today. So these are the five different isolation levels available in SQL Server. Out of these five, first four comes under pessimistic concurrency, and the last one, which is a snapshot isolation level, which comes under optimistic concurrency. So what is this pessimistic and optimistic concurrency? So take this pessimistic concurrency. In this pessimistic one, readers will write, writers will block readers, and sometimes readers will block writers. So what is writer and readers? So whenever you open up a new session, new query window in SQL Server and perform a select operation, that means you are doing some read. So that is called read operation. For example, you open up a new query window in SQL Server and write some update statement. So that means you are writing something. Insert, writing something. Delete, writing something. So whenever you do this kind of DML operations, these are all called writers. So whenever you are in pessimistic concurrency model, that means either you are using one of these four isolation levels in your transaction, then writers will block readers and readers are bound to block writers. So in this case, we can see huge blocking. So this blocking, you can see more whenever you are running your transactions under serializable. So for example, if you see the first one, read uncommitted, which is a first level isolation level available in SQL Server, which offers you more concurrency. If you run your SQL Server in read uncommitted, more number of users can access the database, but there are chances for few inconsistent data problems. So then you will increase the data isolation level to read committed, where you can eliminate few concurrency problems, but you can introduce a concept called blocking. Then to avoid those problems, you will further increase the isolation level to repeatable read so that you can avoid few more inconsistent data problems, but you are blocking few more users. So similarly, whenever you are increasing the level of isolation, you are decreasing the number of users that are able to access the database. So we need to find a good balance where most number of users can access the database. At the same time, we can maintain the consistency. That is where we need to find a balance that we as a developers, IT professionals cannot decide. This is decided by the business. So if your business is acceptable for few problems, then we don't need to bother. We can run any of the isolation level. But if your business is not allowing you to allow those problems, then we have to find a good balancing solution according to this, from these four isolation levels that are available in pessimistic concurrency. So to summarize this, pessimistic concurrency, readers will block writers and writers will block readers. But in optimistic concurrency, writers will not block readers and readers will not write blockers, but writers will always block writers. That is the one thing you need to remember. So if you run your SQL Server in optimistic concurrency, that means you are running your transactions under snapshot isolation level. Readers will not block writers. Writers will not block readers, but writers will always block writers. So this is the points I want to make clear. Friends, if you understand this concept, please put up yes in chat window. Yes, I'm seeing your response in chat. Okay, all yes. We are going good. So now, so before going into demos, I just wanted to go through few concepts about. So someone asked me to repeat optimistic concurrency. So We all know readers and writers, right? Whoever is doing select statement is called readers, and whoever is doing something called insert or update or delete are called as writers. So whenever you run your SQL Server under optimistic concurrency, that means you're running your transactions under snapshot isolation level. That means you're running your SQL Server under optimistic concurrency. If you run in snapshot isolation level, readers will not block writers. At the same time, writers will not block readers. So we can run select query, we can run update query, both will execute at the same time. Either one will block either one. But if you run update query and update query on the same data, this will block. So writers will obviously block writers. So that is under optimistic concurrency. So the main problems that we are going to discuss today are problems that are that will occur when you run your SQL Server under pessimistic concurrency. There are few like dirty reads, non-repeatable reads, or phantom reads. If you run your SQL Server under pessimistic concurrency, you are bound to see few inconsistent data problems. They are called concurrency problems, which are dirty read, non-repeatable read, and phantom reads. Those problems you will not see if you run your SQL Server under optimistic concurrency. So today we are not going to discuss them because we won't get such problems. So we will concentrate more on pessimistic concurrency. So let's go ahead and see few facts about locking before going into demos, because these things are important. This behavior of locking rows or pages in SQL Server will change if you change the isolation level. So to set everything and to make everything clear in demos, I'll just introduce few concepts around locking here. So in SQL Server, we have various locks available called shared lock, exclusive lock, and update lock. And there are few other locks like intent exclusive, schema modification, few other. So basically the idea is very simple. Whenever you're trying to read the data, for example, select start from employee where ID is equal to 1. So you, for example, think like you are reading only one row, select start from employee where ID is equal to 1. You are reading one row. So whenever you are reading data, you are acquiring a shared lock, meaning you take a shared lock. That means you are sharing the data. Someone else also can read the same data. That is how you allow others also to access the same row. So you can also read the same row. I can also read the same row. So if you take a shared lock, another person can also able to read it. But if you take a shared lock and you're reading the data, while you are reading, no one should able to update that, right? So no one should able to update what you are reading. So you take a shared lock and someone tries to update that one, they have to wait. That is called blocking. So why it is blocking? Whenever you want to update a particular row, update employee table, set name is equal to lock hierarchy where ID is equal to 1. This is a simple query. So whenever you want to do that, SQL Server has to acquire an exclusive lock. So there is one more lock type called exclusive lock. If exclusive lock is incompatible with any other lock that are available in SQL Server. So if you have to modify a particular row, you have to acquire an exclusive lock. So only then you can able to modify that particular row. So someone is saying screen is not refreshing. So right now I'm not demonstrating anything. There is one heading called lock hierarchy. So there is nothing coming in. No need to bother. So I think this concept of shared lock and exclusive lock is clear for everyone. If you can able to put up S in chat window, then it's good for us so that we can continue further. Yes, this concept is clear, right? So whenever you're trying to read the data, you're acquiring a shared lock. Whenever you're trying to actually modify the data, you have to acquire an exclusive lock. So these exclusive lock and shared locks are not compatible. So that means if someone is reading the data, other transaction cannot modify the data. So this behavior will change. Some of these behaviors will change the duration of holding this lock will change if you change the isolation levels. So that's why I wanted to introduce this locking concept. So let's see what is this lock hierarchy. So whenever you open up a new query window in SQL Server, you just open up SSMS, click on new query window and select any of the database. For example, AdventureWorks 2012. That's all. You have opened up a new query window and opened up, you connected to AdventureWorks 2012 database. That means you are acquiring a database level lock in SQL Server. So you have acquired a shared lock on that particular database because you are accessing the database. Some other person also can access the database. So you acquired a shared lock. If you want to modify the database, alter database name, then you are modifying the database. So you are going to acquire an exclusive lock. At that particular point of time, no one can access the database. That's why so many times we'll see whenever we modify the database, we use set single user mode with rollback immediate with no wait. That's what we do, right? So that means you are accessing database in single user mode. So idea is very simple. You open up a new query window and connect to a database. Then you are opening up, you are acquiring a shared lock on that particular database. Then the next level of locks are on tables. So you go and open up, you start up querying a table or updating a table, then one more lock will be taken on that particular table. If you have further down partitions, you have a partition tables, then next level is partition lock that is called HOBT locks that we are not discussing now. I'm just discussing a high level hierarchy. So database and then table. After tables, and the data actually lies inside SQL Server in a lowest storage unit called page. So next we are going to lock a page. So these are series of pages. So we'll lock either series of pages or particular page which you are going to access. So after that, the next level in hierarchy is a row. Finally, a lowest level of hierarchy in SQL Server is a row. So first you lock database, then table, then page, and then finally you go and access the particular row. So this is the lock hierarchy that is there available in SQL Server. Let's go ahead and see this one in with another example. So how this locking happens? So you fire this particular query, use AdventureWorks 2012, update employee, set job title is equal to dirty read, where business entity ID equal to 1. Simple update statement, you just connected to AdventureWorks 2012 database and you're firing up an update query. So what happens? So if you fire this query inside SQL Server will first acquire a shared lock on database level. So SQL Server is going to acquire a shared lock on database level. After that, you're trying to update employee table and only one row in employee table. So if you observe in where condition, we have business entity ID is equal to 1. So in this particular table, there is only one record with business entity ID. So we have to log that row. But what SQL Server will do is, SQL Server will take one more lock on that table, which is intent exclusive. So first it will take a database shared level lock and then intent exclusive lock on table and then intent exclusive lock on page. Finally, SQL Server will take an exclusive lock on that particular row. This is what happens whenever you fire up this particular update query. So we can also see this one in action. So why this intent exclusive lock will SQL Server acquire this intent exclusive lock? Anyone, please put up your responses. Why SQL Server is acquiring this intent exclusive locks? So can anyone explain why SQL Server will take this intent exclusive lock on table level and page level? Okay, fine. We'll discuss it. So you opened up a shared database. So any other user can also able to access the same database while you are accessing the same database. Someone replied it. So that row lock can be applied. No concurrent session access the same row by Mahmud. And Rajneet saying so that row lock can be applied. The other DB users may be updating, deleting, inserting at the same time, Satish. while updating the query, it will log because if anyone will be accessed the same ID. So in a way, few of the answers are correct, but I'll tell you the exact answer. One more answer comes in so that no other user will not get exposed. This is exactly correct answer, Bhavesh. So what this intense exclusive lock on table level is saying, so if someone comes and asks exclusive lock on this particular table, these two are incompatible. Why? Because this is saying somewhere down in the hierarchy, I am going to take an exclusive lock. So in this scenario, somewhere down on the row, I'm going to take an exclusive lock. So if you try to modify the table, so I'm accessing this particular object, so this may become invalid. So if you come and want an shared lock, yes, it's granted. If you come and want an exclusive lock on this entire table, it's not going to be granted because somewhere down I'm modifying a particular row. Similarly, in the page level, someone can come and take and read the data. Someone can acquire a shared lock and read the data, but they cannot come and try to modify that particular rows because it is in intent exclusive lock. Here also, intent exclusive lock means somewhere down in the level, I'm acquiring an exclusive lock. So I'm not going to give you an exclusive lock, exclusive access on this entire page because the exclusive lock will read the wrong data. So that's why this is an intent that to protect the data. That's why these are called intent exclusive locks. So that's why SQL Server will take intent exclusive locks on table level and page level. And finally on the actual row, which is with business entry ID equal to 1, it will take an exclusive lock, modify the record and commit the transaction, release the lock. That's what's going to happen inside the SQL Server. Immediately after you commit the transaction or roll back the transaction, this lock will get released. So remember one point, all these locks will get stored in memory. So this is something called lock manager. So which will piece of code called lock manager, which manages everything. It requires some memory. So SQL Server will store all these locks in memory. So it will get stored in memory. So I'll tell why I'm explaining this one is I'm going to explain one more point in the next demo, which is useful for you. So I hope this locking concept also very clear, guys. Please put up S in chat window. So if you have any questions, please put up in Q&A panel. If you put up in chat window, we may lose your questions. So if you put up in Q&A panel at the end of the session, we can read out and go through all the questions. So if you have any questions, please put up in Q&A panel, not in chat window. Thank you. So that's all, friends. We are continue our discussion. So in pessimistic model, if you run your SQL Server in pessimistic concurrency model, we may get different problems like dirty reads, non-repeatable reads, and phantom reads. To avoid these problems, we have to, if your business do not want these problems, then we have to run your transactions under different isolation level. So different isolation level will avoid different problems. So this is the complete table where you can come to know if you run SQL Server in I read committed transaction isolation level, read uncommitted, you may get all these problems. If you run your read committed, you won't get dirty reads, but you are bound to get non-repeatable reads and phantom reads. So this table is, we are going to share this resource so you can go through this table, but I'll show all these things in demo. And I'm not going to discuss this snapshot because snapshot comes under optimistic concurrency where all these problems will not occur. So let's go ahead and see things in action. So I'm going to open up my SSMS. So while demoing all these things, I'll explain what is dirty read and what is non-repeatable read and what is phantom read. So in the same line, we can get the definitions as well. So I have opened up an SSMS. So I'm running under AdventureWorks database. So let me create a staging table. I don't want to mess up with original table. So I'll I'll create a staging table, which we are going to use in our demos. So I'm just copying all the data from human resources to employee table into another staging table. And I'll go ahead and run all these scripts against the employee table. So we have to run this update query in connection one. Connection one means one query window, and connection two means another query window. So let me copy this particular code and open up a new query window and paste it here. So we have two connections. One is this. Let me arrange like this. So we have transaction one, which is in connection one, and we have other transaction in another connection. So consider this left hand side is connection one and right hand side is connection two. So what connection one is doing? We have started an explicit transaction and updating an employee table where business entity ID equal to one, update job title as dirty read. Before this update, what is the job title of this particular employee? Go ahead and execute this particular query and see, before the update, the job title of this particular row is chief executive officer, CEO. So we are changing the CEO to dirty. So issuing this particular, if you update this particular row and we have started an explicit transaction and updating this query, and I clicked on execute, while this transaction is running. So this transaction is on fly because we didn't commit it or we didn't roll back it. So this transaction is on fly, and in the same time, I am running this transaction under read uncommitted isolation level. So I want to tell you one more point before we continue. By default, SQL Server runs all the transactions under read committed isolation level. This is SQL Server default. Whenever you open up a new query window and simply write some queries, that means you are running your SQL Server under read committed isolation level. That is default behavior of SQL Server. When it comes to Azure, that is read committed snapshot, that is different. But when it comes to on-premise SQL Server, the default isolation level is read committed. So your connection one is running under read committed, but your connection two is running under read uncommitted isolation level. So what happens if you run your query under read uncommitted isolation level? So I have started this. Now if I execute this one, I'll get this output, right? So I have got this output. If I go ahead and see the job title of this particular row, it is, the value is dirty read. So what do you mean by that? That means you are getting the updated data. So the transaction is on fly. It's not either committed or rolled back, but we have seen the value which is not committed. So let's go ahead and roll back this particular query instead of committing this query. So let's assume this transaction started, updated the row, and it continuing, and some error occurred. So that entire transaction has to roll back. So now I'm rolling back this transaction. And if I read this row again, we'll get chief executive officer. So what happened? So earlier this transaction started, I'll just roll back these transactions that I have started here. So there is no transaction. I'll repeat this thing again. So I have started the transaction here, and this transaction also started and started reading the data, which is the dirty read. Now, instead of committing this transaction, I rolled back this transaction. And if you go ahead and see the value of the job title, it is CEO. So the actual value of CEO, actual value is CEO, but this particular transaction read dirty read. So this, according to this transaction, the job title of employee ID, business entity ID one is dirty read, but actually the job title of business entity ID one is executive officer. This particular read is called dirty read. So we are reading the dirty read just because we are reading uncommitted data. This is called dirty read. So let me roll back this particular transaction that we have started. Similarly, so if you run this particular query using with no lock option. So how many of you use this no lock? please put up async chart window if you are using your select statement using no lock hint. Okay, there are so many people who are using no lock hint. So if you are using no lock hint, that means you are bound to get this kind of a dirty read problems. So what happens is, running your particular query using with no lock hint is equal to running your transaction under read uncommitted in a way. So that means you are bound to get all the dirty read problems, non-repeatable read problems. If you look at this particular slide, we have all these problems. So if you run your particular query using no lock hint that is equivalent to read uncommitted, so you are bound to get dirty reads, non-repeatable reads, and phantom reads. Someone commented in this chat window that they are using it in reporting. Sometimes if you use that in reporting and you start the sales amount in the beginning and do some calculations and read the same sales amount, calculate the sales sum at the end, you are bound to get different values. So be careful while using with no lock hint. Let me show you that as well. So I have started this transaction, which is on fly, neither committed nor rollback. I am running this particular query with no lock. I'll get this output as dirty read. If you see, the output is dirty read. Now, instead of committing, I'll roll back. The actual value here now is, actual value is chief executive officer, but the value you read is dirty read. So this is what happens if at all you run using with no lock hint. So you have to be very, very logical. You have to prove why you are using with no lock hint. You just want the data immediately, even though you are reading inconsistent data. If your business accepts that, fine, you can go ahead and use it. But if your business do not accept these dirty read problems, non-repeatable problems, and phantom reads, so don't use with no lock hint. So changing this transaction isolation levels is very, very easy. Write this simple statement before opening up a session, then that's all. Your sessions will run in that particular isolation level. But this is not that easy to decide this one. So because which isolation level we have to run, it is decided by the business. So we don't have full control on selecting these isolation levels. I think that being said, I want to show you one more thing. Which is this one. So let me roll back all the transactions that I have started. Yes, all the transactions are rolled back already. So if at all we modify a table, consider this scenario. Sorry. So consider this scenario. I am trying to add a new column to employee table. I'm adding some temporary column, which is of ID, integer data type. I'm adding this particular column to employee table by modifying the table. So if this thing is going on, I have started an explicit transaction. I'm not committing it or rolling back it. So I have started this transaction and this is on fly. Now, if you run your particular query with no lock hint, this will wait. So this will wait forever, because even though you're running your SQL query with no lock hint, or else you are running your transaction under read uncommitted, you cannot read the data from the table which is being modified by another transaction. So why? I am going to show you one more query here, so which will show us all the locks that are acquired by this particular transaction. So this particular session ID is 52. I am running this alter table in 52. And if I go ahead and see 52, session number 52 has exclusive locks. So let me roll back this particular alter table statement. Then immediately you see the output is coming in this particular transaction. So this is what happens. So the idea is very simple. Even though you use with no lock hint, or you are running your SQL server under read uncommitted, you will still be blocked if that particular table is getting modified, the schema of that particular table is getting modified. That's the point I want to make here. So how to avoid this rutty-read problem? So just run this particular query. Just run this particular query under read committed isolation level instead of read uncommitted. So let me repeat the same thing. So I have started the same transaction again. I didn't commit it, neither rolled back it, and I am running this particular query. I'm waiting. So unless this transaction completes, completing means either commits or roll back, we are not getting output on the right hand side. So we are blocked. So once you commit this transaction or roll back the transaction, then immediately we'll get the output. That means we are read data. So roll back it. Then if you see job title as chief executive officer, and if you see the transaction or job title value here also chief executive officer. So that means you're reading only committed data. That's what you are telling to SQL Server: read committed data only. So if you run your SQL Server under read committed, you can avoid dirty read problems. Let's go ahead and discuss one more problem called non-repeatable read problem. So I'm not saving this. I'll close this as well. So let me open up a non-repeatable read problem. So I'm using the same. So one more point before we continue. So whenever you start SQL Server under read committed transaction isolation level, and you start reading a session, you're starting reading a value using select statement, this under read committed isolation level, I'll just continue, and then now while continuing, we can discuss the same thing, no issues. So I'm copying this particular query in new query window. Let me arrange it in vertical tab groups. So we have this particular set of query transaction under query in query in connection one, and we have another query in connection two. So in connection one, what we are doing, we have started our transaction under read committed isolation level, and we have started an explicit transaction, and we are running a select statement here. So we are reading the job title value from employee table where ID is equal to 1, and then some business logic is going on. To simulate that business logic, I have introduced some delay of 5 seconds. So consider this as some business logic is running. So after this business logic completes, I am reading the same row again. So same row I am reading at the beginning of the transaction, and same row I am reading at the end of the transaction. This is what I am doing. So while this is going on, in the second window, I am trying to update the same row where business entity ID equal to 1. Here also I am accessing business entity equal to 1. Here also I am updating the job title of the person who is having business entity ID is equal to 1. So this is what I am doing it. So let's see what's going to happen. Execute this one first, and then come here, execute this one as well. So let's wait for 5 seconds. We have got the result. So in the single transaction, I'm repeating the same select statement twice, but I got different outputs in two select statements. So I tried to read the same row twice in that transaction. In single transaction, when I read for the first time, my value is chief executive officer. When I read for the second time, my value is different. Non-repeatable read, chief executive officer. If I zoom in, you can see it very clear. So what's happening here? I'm not able to repeat the same read again. So this problem is called as non-repeatable read problem. So I'm trying to repeat the same read, but I'm not getting the same value. So this problem is called as non-repeatable read problem. So why this is happening? So you are running your transaction under read committed isolation level. And what is the behavior of read committed isolation level is, immediately after the select statement completes, while you are doing it, acquire a shared lock, and then you complete the read, release the shared lock, and continue further. This is the behavior of a read committed transaction. Whenever you run your transaction under read committed, SQL Server will acquire a shared lock on select statement. Immediately after the read completes, it will release the lock. So that's why, just because this particular row released the lock, this transaction comes in and inserted, updated the row. So that's why we are able to see different values in the same transaction. That's what happened. So this is called non-repeatable read problem. So how to avoid that? So let me show you, same example using repeatable read. So to avoid this non-repeatable read problem, you have to run your transaction under repeatable read isolation level. So this is how you set your transaction under repeatable read isolation level. Now I'm repeating the same thing again. So let's do the same thing again. So try to execute this particular query. Now, if you observe, what is the value of job title? Our job title now current value is non-repeatable read. If I execute this particular query, I'm executing this particular query twice in the transaction. So I have to get the same value multiple times, right? So I'm executing this query, execute it and run it. So what happens? So let me stop this because So let me close this one. So let me commit everything so that, okay, we are good now. So I have opened up multiple transactions and I didn't commit it or rollback it. That's the problem. So if you see the employee value before anything goes, this is the current job title of employee where whose ID is equal to 1. So let me do this. Copying this particular query, open up in a new query window, paste it here and do vertical tab. So now I'm running the same transaction under repeatable read isolation level, execute this and at the same time execute this. So after 5 seconds delay, we'll get the output on the left hand side. Something is going wrong. Yes. So if you observe, I have introduced a 15 second delay here. So earlier I introduced only 5 second delay. So I'm thinking that I have introduced 5 only. So I have introduced 15 second delay here. So after 15 seconds, we have got the output. Okay. So what happened? If you observe the output, both the outputs are same. The first one is also non-repeatable read chief executive officer. And the second one is also non-repeatable read chief executive officer. So what happened? So we are able to repeat the same read again. So what happens if you run your SQL Server under repeatable read is this particular shared lock acquired by this transaction will not get released until unless we commit or roll back the transaction. So earlier in read committed isolation level, we are reading this row, releasing the lock and then continuing. But if you run your transaction under repeatable read isolation level, we hold this transaction, we hold this shared lock on this particular row, but we are not going to release that. SQL Server will not release that lock until unless we commit or roll back that particular transaction. So we have something come up in chat window. Can you please change the update value to CEO? Did you change the job title value back? So these things, because the idea is very simple. If you want to see that, this guy will get blocked until unless we'll commit or roll back the transaction. So let me execute the same transaction without this. So see this. So what is the current value of, I have this question that the problem is with this update query. So I'm just proving that. Let me execute this particular query first. So what is the value? Non-repeatable read. So the current value is non-repeatable read and this query is trying to update to chief executive officer. So let's not bother about anything. I'm just starting up this particular query and I'm not committing it, right? So I have started this transaction under repeatable read isolation level and I'm not committing it. And I have started this update. Let me wait for 15 seconds. So this transaction gave the output. The select statement after 15 seconds delay gave me the output non-repeatable read non-repeatable read, but if you observe, this query is getting blocked. If you observe, this connection 2 is getting blocked. As I told you, this update query requires an exclusive lock on this particular row, but this transaction holds a shared lock on that particular row. As we already discussed, if you run your SQL Server transaction under repeatable read, until unless this transaction commits all rollbacks, the shared lock will not get released. So shared locks and exclusive locks are incompatible. So this query has to wait until unless this commits or rollbacks. I hope this answers the question. So the people who put up question in chat window. Yes, thank you. So if I commit this transaction, immediately this update is going to work. Now the value of business entity ID is back to CEO, right? So this is what happens. So let me show you this in action. So I have started this transaction under repeatable read. So this transaction is running and it will complete anyway in 15 seconds. But the key point is I'm not committing it or not rolling back it. So let's go ahead and see what are the locks that are getting acquired in this particular session. So I'm running this in session ID 52. If you see, I'm running this particular transaction under 52. If you go back to this one, so I'm just seeing what are the locks that are acquired by SQL Server using this DMV called sysdmtranlock. This is the DMV which will show us what types of locks we have acquired. So under session ID 52, if you see on session ID 52, I have acquired a shared lock on this particular row. I have acquired a shared lock on this particular row and I have acquired an intent shared locks on this page. As we already discussed, if you take a shared lock in the higher level, it will take an intent shared lock on the page level, intent shared lock on table level, and shared lock on database level. This is what's going to happen, right? So right now we have acquired a shared lock on this particular row. If you observe this, RID means row because we do not have index on it. So RID means a row, and we have acquired a shared lock on that particular row. It is still there. The lock is still there because we didn't commit or roll back the transaction. So if you commit the transaction, that lock will get released. So that lock will get released. So I committed the transaction, if I go ahead and see, there are no locks on that particular object. So I hope this helps the people who are asking questions in chat window. Please put up S if it's clear for you. Yes, thank you. So let me quickly go ahead and show you about phantom reads as well. So let me close this. And let me close this as well. If I have any uncommitted transactions, I'll commit it. Okay, we don't have any uncommitted transactions. So let me open up phantom reads. So we are running out of time. I'll just go through this particular phantom reads very quickly. So anyway, I'm running in the same AdventureWorks database. And in connection 2, I'm going to run this insert statement. And if I open up a new query window and I paste it here. So this sets up our demo. So if you observe, now I'm running this transaction under repeatable read isolation level. So the point is very clear. This phantom read will also happen if you run this transaction under read commit. That's why I'm not going to show you. Anyway, I'm showing it in repeatable read. You can try if the same thing will happen in read committed or not. So I'm telling you it will happen, but you can go ahead and try. Now I have already increased the isolation level to repeatable read. So even though we are running our transaction under repeatable read, we are still bound to get few problems. So that we are going to discuss now. So we are starting a transaction. So phantom reads are of different types. It can occur in different ways. I'm just showing you one of the type. So there are different ways as well. If you repeat the same select statement again, also this phantom reads will come, but I'm showing it in different way. So if I execute this particular query, what we are going is I'm running this transaction under repeatable read isolation level and beginning an explicit transaction, deleting 10 rows from employee table between ID 1 and 10 and waiting for 10 seconds delay and then reading those rows. So according to me, I'm deleting these 10 rows. If I execute this particular statement, I should not get any value because I'm deleting it. So according to me, I'm deleting it. I'm just selecting it back. So there should be no value. So I'm just executing this particular statement. While this is going on, this particular transaction comes in and inserted 10 rows in the same range, ID between 1 and 10. By the time it completes 10 seconds, I am able to see all the 10 records again. So according to me, there should be no record between ID 1 and 10 because I have deleted it. But other transaction comes in and inserted these rows. So I have seen these rows. So this is called phantom read problem. So it may occur in different form as well. If you execute one statement, one row will not be there. If you execute the same statement again, extra row will come. So these are all called phantom records. So how to avoid these phantom records? So if you run your transaction under serializable isolation level like this, you can avoid phantom reads. So I'm running SQL Server under this particular transaction under serializable isolation level. Let me execute this same transaction, but different isolation level. Let me execute this and try to insert these values. If you see, I didn't commit this transaction or roll back this transaction until unless this transaction commits or rollbacks, this cannot execute. This is waiting. If you observe this particular thing, it is waiting here. So until unless I commit this transaction or roll back this transaction, we cannot able to insert these 10 rows. So what is going on here? So whenever you do something like this, whenever you run your SQL Server under serializable, SQL Server will acquire key range locks on this entire range of rows. So these locks, SQL Server will hold these locks until unless you commit or roll back the transaction. Right now, SQL Server is holding these locks. That's why we are not able to complete the insert operation. If I roll back this transaction or commit the transaction, let me commit this. Immediately, this insert can continue. So there are multiple transactions, seems like. Yes. So I've started multiple transactions. So I just committed these transactions, then insert completes. Now, if you go ahead and see, we have all these 10 rows available in SQL Server. So if you run your transaction under serializable isolation level, you can avoid. But the problem is whenever you increase the isolation, transaction isolation level, you are blocking so many users, so many sessions. So blocking will increase if you increase the level of isolation level. If you go to higher level isolation, the concurrency will be less. If you use lower level isolation, the concurrency will be more. So these are all concurrency problems that are occurring in SQL Server. So someone asked this question about whether intent exclusive is compatible with intent exclusive. So here is a detailed table to see which lock is compatible with other lock. This is a basic one. There are a few more options. There are a very big chart, but I have just put here a basic level compatibility options. So intent exclusive is compatible with intent exclusive is also compatible with intent exclusive, but it's not compatible with update, share, and exclusive lock. So this is the lock compatibility chart. So before I take Q&A, I'll request Rohit to take over.
Yes, thank you so much, Satya, for that wonderful session. Let me just share my screen. All right. So like I said earlier, we have Facebook, LinkedIn, and Telegram groups. Please do join us there to connect with like-minded people. And a word from our sponsors, SQL Maestros. We do a lot of advanced training on SQL Server and Microsoft Data Platform and the hands-on labs on-site training that I was talking about earlier. If you have any queries regarding that, do write to us at classes@sqlmaestros.com. And we are coming up with online masterclasses. We have tied up with some of the best trainers from over the world to deliver 8-hour deep dive trainings on Microsoft Data Platform and SQL Server. Any queries regarding that? Again, classes at sqlmaestros.com and visitors at sqlmaestros.com. We have hands-on labs. You can try a few of them as you're already DPG members. We have a few free demos that you can utilize. And once again, thank you all for your time. Hope you had a great session. Do visit our YouTube channel as well. A lot of recorded webinars, our official website, dataplatformgeeks.com. And please don't forget to give us your feedback. We have a Facebook group. I will put down the link shortly. Do give us your feedback. It is very valuable to us. And thank you so much. Thank you so much, Satya. You can take over now.